today.
According to the book of Hebrews, do you remember what I preached on last week? And you're going to say, no, I don't really remember, Pastor Tim. I preached on, I told you that it was a little bit late. I really wanted to preach it at the first Sunday of the year, but keeping the faith. The writer of Hebrews has spent the first, basically, 10 chapters explaining what Jesus Christ has done for us when he came to earth and he died and he's become a high priest for us and he's now up in heaven. He's bought it with his blood. He sprinkled his blood on the altar in the presence of God. And in light of everything that God has done for us, in light of everything that Jesus Christ has done for us, he's imploring us as he finishes out this book. He's saying, keep the faith. And in the 11th chapter of Hebrews, he gives the names of a lot of people that exercised faith. He talks about Noah. He talks about Moses. He talks about Abraham. And so as he moves into this 11th chapter, or the 12th chapter, Hebrews chapter 12, he says, so since you've got all of these great examples of people that live by faith, I want you people to make this your goal in life. That's why I said I really wish that I could have preached this on the first Sunday in the month of January. Because our goal in life ought to be to get to heaven. And how do you get to heaven? Through faith in Jesus Christ. One of the things that I tried to bring out with last Sunday's message was that oftentimes faith and our faith commitment to God can get crowded out by other things within our lives. There are so many competing things out there for our time and our attention and our allegiance. And I just kind of warn you, work hard to strengthen your commitment to the Lord. Don't allow it to get weaker. As you get older, strengthen it. The older that I get, I realize that my life here on earth is running out. I don't want to get off on a chasing a rabbit, so to speak, here at this point. But most of you folks, I told you, I think last week, I'm in the process of trying to buy a house over closer to my dad. And it's got lots of storage. And people have kidded me and they said, that means you can go to a lot more yard sales and buy a lot more stuff and you can end up having all the stuff. And I said, you know, that's not my intent. I'm going to turn 62 here in just a few weeks. And I'm going to start getting my Social Security check beginning of April. And I'm coming to realize life's running out. And the older that I get, the more I recognize faith is what life is all about. Sooner or later, all of these other things that you and I have placed all of our time and attention, all of those things are going to be taken away from us. I was talking with my dad last night. We walked down there to that house and we looked at it. I said, boy, that's a nice house. I said, if I live another 20 years, I'll be 82 years of age. Some of y'all say, that's nothing. 82 is still a youngster. But the reality is, should I make 82 years of age, life's just about over. And so I need to make sure that I'm focused upon those things that are going to be eternal. That's one of the great things that I've learned as I've gotten older. Nothing on this earth is eternal. My dad and I both grieve the fact that mom is no longer here. I went down there yesterday. My dad kind of had a rough week emotionally, you know, really missing my mom. And so I had a bunch of videos on my phone of my mom. And I sent them to him on his phone. And he sat there probably for an hour and a half yesterday afternoon and watch those videos, and sometimes he just break down and cry and the tears running down his face. And he said to me on more than one occasion this past week, he says, I sure do miss my mom. Miss mom. And I said, yeah, Pop, I miss mom too. But our faith is what keeps us going. We're separated for now. But there's coming a day we're going to be back together. And so having said all that, I'm tying that into this message. Faith, folks. The writer of Hebrews is saying, in light of the fact of everything that God has done for you, in light of the fact that you've got some great examples that he uses in chapter 11, he says, folks, you've been surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses, so pursue this faith. Keep your faith in God. And I don't want to just say that faith is just one area of your life. Faith affects every area of your life. You demonstrate your faith by what you do. And so that's what I want to take a look at this morning as you go through the 12th chapter and into the 13th chapter. The writer of Hebrews gives us some things that we can demonstrate that we are actively seeking God. I could even go back to the 10th chapter, but I'm going to stay focused upon these. I'm going to start at the 7th verse. I actually could start a little bit earlier than that, but he says in the 7th verse, he says, endure hardship as discipline. God is treating you as sons. And I just want to comment. I believe that the apostle that wrote this, a lot of people think that the apostle Paul wrote it. There's some, you know, argument of whether or not he did write it. But whoever it was that was writing it was very much aware that life for Christians during that time was difficult. It was hard. We don't even begin to understand how hard life can be in this country. There is religious persecution that's going on within this country. Make no mistake about it. But as things get hard, oftentimes people have a tendency to say, well, I don't like hardship, so I'm going to back off. I'll use this as an example. Do you remember the name Kim Davis? Anybody here remember the name Kim Davis? She was in the news here a few years ago, down in the state of Kentucky. Still doesn't register. Her job, and I can't remember what her title was, but it was to issue marriage licenses. County clerk, okay. And she refused. So what happened to her? What else? Oh, they haven't aired that part of the story? They recently fined her that she's responsible for all of the legal costs associated with that whole trial thing. And she's on the hook for like $290,000. She's fighting it. I'm bringing this up because it's a hardship brought on by your faith. Some of you people may not have hardship of an employer that's giving you a rough time because of your faith, but you're given a rough time by your family because they don't support you in your faith walk. And they may even mock you and ridicule you. And I'm preaching this part of the message to say that, folks, hardship during the times of Jesus was expected when you became a Christian. I personally continue to try to pray every day for the pastors over in the country of Eritrea that I became aware of late last year. These guys have spent the last 18 years in prison for no other reason than they're Christians. And they were doing what we do freely every Sunday. 18 years these guys have been subjected to prison life. And quite honestly, they're not sure if they're ever going to get out. And I'm just trying to bring out to you that Jesus even warned, you know, his followers when he was here. He said, guys, I want you to understand, if the people treat me bad because of my faith commitment with God, please understand you guys aren't any better than me. Don't be surprised when they do to you what they do to me. And I'm going to add to what I'm saying. When hardship comes, the temptation is back off and get out from under the pressure. And again, the message that I'm trying to preach to you is strengthen your faith.
Don't back down.
If the hardship comes, the writer of Hebrews says, God has not abandoned you. God is working with you through that experience to make you a stronger person. And you and I say, I don't need that kind of strength. You may not recognize the fact that you need it, but your heavenly Father, who knows far more about you than you ever will, knows what He's doing.
The writer of Hebrews says, keep faith. Sometimes it's just a dogged determination of, I know what's right to do and I'm going to keep doing it. I don't know that I can even take one more step, but by the grace of God, I'm going to try. And I will keep putting one foot in front of the other because I know it's what God wants to do, and that is the only thing that matters. It's to be found in the will of your Heavenly Father, who in those midst of those hardships is saying, I hate to put you through it, but there's a purpose behind it. You're going to need the strength that you're getting through this experience for the days that come down the road. I marvel at my brothers and sisters in the country of Nigeria. It's not all through the country of Nigeria. It's the southern part is basically more open and friendly toward Christianity, but in the northern part of Nigeria, some people say, I don't even know where the country of Nigeria is. But I can tell you this much. The people there love God regardless of what the circumstances are. I've told you before, I don't know if you're recognizing this or not. But in the country of Nigeria, every single day, 13 or 14 Christians are killed for their faith. And the way that they are killed by the Muslim community that is trying to exterminate them, it's brutal the way they're killed. The Muslims don't necessarily just come in with guns and put a bullet in everybody. They come in with machetes and they literally chop people and hack people to death. And in spite of the hardship that these people in Nigeria are going through, they continue to meet together to worship the same God that we worship. And their attitude is, nobody is going to separate me from the love that I've found in Christ Jesus, my Lord. Our God rules and He reigns, even in the pain and the heartache of life, and our God is worthy of worship. Tell you what, I honestly believe it's coming down the road for America. I don't know that it's going to reach that level that's going on in Nigeria. But I honestly believe that the persecution of Christians is just going to increase. People say, well, that's the pessimistic side of you, Pastor Tim. I say, no, it's not the pessimistic side of me. It's the prophetic side of me. I don't claim to be a prophet, but I do claim to read the prophecies recorded in the Word of God, and the Word of God says that in the last days it's going to get tough. And I preach the message to you this morning because you want to say, what is the first step that I can end up taking in order to make sure I'm growing stronger in my faith? First step that you could take is to make sure you don't back up or back down from where you are now. I am here in the house of God because I know that's where I need to be. And when I'm not in the house of God and I'm sitting there at home and I get out that Bible every day and I get out my daily bread and I sit there and I have my private time with God, I know that that's what God wants me to do. And when I continue to support the work of the local church, I know that that's what God wants me to do. Faith is about not what you say. Faith is about what you do through your actions. The writer of Hebrews here is talking in the 12th verse or 12th chapter. He says, folks, I know you're going to have some hardship, but I want you to endure that hardship. And you need to understand that God is not punishing you. God is allowing you an opportunity to go through something that's going to strengthen you in the long run. God is still in charge in the tough times. It's my younger brother who's home with the Lord now. Still remember him years ago. It wasn't original with him. I remember an insight that the Lord had given him. He said, if you'll notice, when you see mountains, and I'm not talking about, you know, the smaller ones that we hear. I'm talking about the ones like Mount Everest. You don't notice any trees growing up there. Those mountains are great for standing up there and seeing everything. They're great. But my little brother, he had heard it somewhere. He said, but the growth comes in the valleys. You have to come down from off those mountains to where the valleys are, where the tough experiences of life begin to shape you and to make you into the image of Jesus Christ. Growth occurs in the valleys. Don't curse the valleys. God's producing good things in you there. He says there in that seventh verse, endure hardship as discipline. God is treating you as sons. For what son is not disciplined by his father? If you are not disciplined, and everyone undergoes discipline, then you are illegitimate children and not true sons. Moreover, we have all had human fathers who disciplined, and we respected them for it. How much more should we submit to the Father of our spirits and live? Our fathers disciplined us for a little while as they thought best, but God disciplines us for our good, that we may share in his holiness. No discipline seems pleasant at the time, but painful. Later on, however, it produces a harvest of righteousness and peace for those who have been trained for it. So therefore, strengthen your feeble arms and your weak knees. Strengthen them. Don't give up. Don't quit. Don't say, I've had enough and I'm done. God says, you keep coming back. I'm working. And you're going to like what you see when I'm finished. Make level paths for your feet so that the lame may not be disabled, rather healed. So this is just one thing that he talks about here, is that you want to exhibit your faith, get stronger, not weaker. He goes on in the 14th verse, make every effort to live at peace with all men. Folks, I'm not out to create a big issue. I try to get along with people, and that's what the writer of Hebrews says. You want to demonstrate your faith, you're not going to win a lot of people to Jesus if you're all the time raising Cain. Let people know that you're a person of peace, that you really want peace, not only between people, but you want peace between us and God. He says, make every effort to live in peace with all men. And what is the next little portion of the phrase here? What does he say? Make every effort to live in peace with all men and to be holy. Why am I pausing there? I rejoice these days. I'm seeing a lot of stories about people, high-profile people that are becoming Christians. I'm excited about that. I do have a concern. And you're like, oh, sure, you have a concern. You always have a concern, Pastor Tim. What is my concern? My concern is that it's not just enough to call yourself a Christian. You need to act like a Christian. Some of the ones that I've heard, you know, recently, I know that the guy that was quarterback for the Houston Texans, C.J. Stroud, former graduate of Ohio State. I don't know if he graduated, but I know he played for Ohio State. Went there, led them to the playoff. I think that they lost in the first round or whatnot, but
when they were interviewing after in the playoffs, he won. First thing he did was give credit to God. To God be the glory. John Harbaugh, who led his team into the playoffs, first thing he did, he stepped up the microphone, wanted to give praise and honor to God. Jim Harbaugh, who was the coach of Michigan Wolverines, which Ohio State people don't like. I get it. Jim Harbaugh gave credit to God for what he did. And I even appreciated the last week when they had the march, or the Right to Life March in Washington, D.C. Jim Harbaugh, coach of the Michigan Wolverines, showed up there and was a keynote speaker. One other thing, people are like, have you become a Michigan Wolverine fan? No, I haven't, but I read a story this past week because the coach, Jim Harbaugh, said that leading up to, and by the way, Michigan won the national championship college football. They actually beat my team, Alabama Crimson Tide. Don't worry, I'll get over it. Can't win them all. But he said, leading up to their win of the national championship, 70 players on the Michigan team got baptized. Folks, I'm thrilled to death to hear this. I'm seeing more and more athletes, they're not the only ones, giving credit to God. But I want to make it very clear here. The Word of God says, don't leave holiness out of your life. And if I do have a pet peeve these days, is that Christianity, in a lot of ways, has been hijacked. What do you mean it's been hijacked? People want to believe that holiness doesn't matter to God if you're a Christian. And I want to tell you, the two are inseparable. If you claim to be a Christian and there is no holiness within your life, I will question personally whether or not you've ever come to know Jesus Christ. Because God is holy, and he has said, if you're going to be my people, I want you to be holy too. Holiness doesn't mean that you walk around with your nose in the air, but there are just some basic things that are present within our society these days. Language? The language that you're using doesn't match up with the Christian experience. You need to look at whether or not you've actually been saved, because I will tell you this much. Jesus will get rid of that potty mouth. It's not just language. We got Christians out there that think that voting for abortion and candidates support abortion is okay. It's not okay. Shame on you. I don't care how much you say you love babies. If you vote for abortion, you just have them killed by the millions. We got people with homosexuality think that that's okay. Transgenderism, lesbianism, all sorts of stuff. People end up thinking, it's okay. No, the Word of God says you've got to be a holy people. There's coming a day, do you not understand that when you stand before God, God is going to end up calling you to account on all this stuff? There are going to be some people, it says in the Gospels, it's going to some people say, Lord, Lord, and he's going to say, why did you call me Lord, Lord, and you didn't do a single thing that I told you? And then even more scary, he says, depart from me. I never knew you. And I'm just telling you right now, the Word of God says, if you're going to be his people and you're going to pursue a faith relationship to him, you better take seriously holiness. I know that we're big on our church of singing about amazing grace. But the Apostle Paul writes in the book of Romans, he says there's a lot of people out there abusing grace. They think that grace is just basically a license to do whatever you want, say anything that you want, and God is going to forgive it all. And I'm going to tell you right now, God can and will forgive, but God is also going to hold you accountable. And you demonstrate who your boss is by how you tell you this much about growing up in our household. I feared my dad. My dad's not very big. I think tallest he ever was, 5'7". But he reminded us from when we came into this world, dynamite comes in small packages. Amen. and I would have never uttered in his presence language that I hear people say. I will tell you what, God's a lot more powerful than what my dad is. It's not just our language. It's the stuff that we do. It's the places we go. It's the stuff that we watch. And I'm telling you right now, the writer of Hebrews says, I want you to pursue faith. But faith isn't just saying, I believe God. Faith is how you live out your beliefs. Faith is what you do. The writer of the book of James says, faith without works is dead. It's good for nothing. You might as well take that faith and bury it in the ground because it can't do anything. But the writer of James says, let me show you my faith by my works. In the works that I'm going to do, this is my prayer. I'll close the message right now. The works that I want to do is, I don't care how tough things get for me this next year. I want to get stronger in my walk with the Lord. I don't want to back up. I want to move forward. I want to make sure that I end up focusing on holiness. I want to make sure that the things that I say, the things that I do, and I'll tell you one that I'm really struggling right now. I don't know how much you spend time struggling with this or not. But the things that I think, I find myself more and more saying, Lord, you know what? What I just thought broke your heart. I'm sorry. I pray as your pastor that as you move further into 2024, that you might strengthen your faith. And I will tell you what, it will pay huge dividends down the road. Shall we pray? Father, we've come together in your house this morning, as we usually do, to not only sing your praises, to maybe give you offerings to bring to you our request, but we've come into your house to hear your word, to hear you speak to our hearts, to say to us, Lord, to hear us saying, Lord, what do I need to do that I might become a better servant of yours? I pray this morning, Father, that the message might be an encouragement to us. I don't want it to come across as scolding or to make anybody feel unworthy, but I pray that it might inspire us to be more serious about our faith walk. Many times, Father, we don't realize that our faith may seem to be hanging on by a thread. All that it would take is for something else to come into our lives, and next thing you know, we would basically give up on, you know, going to church, or we might give up on reading your word because there are other things that pull us away. My heart's prayer, Father, is that as we go through 2024, we won't be pulling away, but we might working to become stronger in our faith. Ultimately, Lord, when we come to the end of our lives, all that we're going to have left is that relationship with you. So help us not to abandon it. I pray, Father, if there are decisions that need to be made this morning, that you might help us to make those decisions, whether it's outwardly or inwardly. But pray, Father, that we might grow stronger in our faith in you and our love and our service to you. Have your will and your way at this invitation time and move us closer to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Our hymn of invitation is number 482. We stand.
Farther and farther away.
you might constantly be listening to the voice of the Lord. I will guarantee you this. There will never be anybody else in all the world that loves you more than he does. And whether or not you realize it, he wants the best for you. When you hear the voice of Jesus calling, respond and say yes, Lord, to whatever he asks. All hearts and minds clear. Thank you for being here in the house of the Lord this morning. Let's be dismissed, closing with prayer. Cheryl, would you lead us closing with prayer, please?
Heavenly Father, as we go.